Hello friends, as you were seeing me using a magnifying lens, okay, we are going to start our lectures on optical microscope, of course, which use some magnifying lens like this, and how they are arranged to get a magnified image in the eyepiece. Okay, so to start, I'll introduce you to optical microscope first, and in that we will look at some concepts like magnification, okay, and what is useful magnification. See, we cannot keep on magnifying any image to any extent, okay, and ultimately there has to be some useful magnification. So we will try to understand that what do we mean by this concept of useful magnification, and that is very intimately related to the resolution, okay, that whether you are able to resolve the features which you are interested in or not, okay. So this useful magnification is related to resolution, and then we will see two other concepts which are related to microscope. These are depth of field and depth of focus, okay. So all these terms we will see, we will try to analyze what do we mean by each of these term, and how it is useful to get a good microstructure in a sample. To start with, this is your high school physics, okay, there is a thin lens equation here. So let me use explain it with an schematic here. What do we mean by V, U and F, okay? So suppose we have an optical axis of a thin lens. Of course, I am exaggerating the convexity of this particular lens here, okay, and these are the focal point of this particular lens, okay, and let us say I am keeping an object here away from the focal length here, F, this is my object, okay, and suppose there is a parallel ray which is coming and striking this particular object, okay. Then how the rays will propagate from here and interact with the lens, okay, so after interacting with the lens it will go through the focal point here, okay. Another ray which is going through the center of the lens, okay, there will not be any divergence, it will go straight like this, okay, and you will see a inverted image forming at this particular location, okay, and now we can define all these values, okay. So the U is your distance from the lens of the object, okay. V is the distance of image from the object, okay, and F is your focal length, okay, and this is the thin lens equation. Of course, you will have to keep in mind the sign convention which we use here. Any distance we are measuring in the direction of the ray will be positive, and anything which we are measuring in the direction opposite to the rays here will be negative. Okay, so for all your calculation, please keep the sign convention in mind. Okay. I can also define a magnification here, which is given by the distance of the image from the lens and the distance of the object from the lens, okay. And of course, if you replace V and U with F here, you will get the other two relations which is shown in the slide. This is how, this is what is used in a compound microscope or a metallurgical microscope. Okay, so let me tell you the whole illumination schematic of a compound microscope, which is sometime you can call as metallurgical microscope also. To distinguish a metallurgical microscope from a biological microscope, which you might have seen in your school, okay, if you have done some biological experiments, okay. In case of metallurgical microscope, the illumination is by reflection, okay. So the rays gets reflected from the object and then it again goes back to in the objective and then you form the image. Whereas in case of biological samples, okay, the image transmit through the sample and then it goes to objective and you form the image. Okay. So in case of metallurgical or microscope, the illumination is by reflection, and I'll just show you what kind of schematic is there, the ray diagram for that. This is also called a compound microscope because more than one lens will be used to form the image. Okay. So first I will draw the parts of the of a microscope. So you have a source, okay, a light source. I'll write down that a light source. Okay, then you have apertures here. Okay, and then you have a what we call as a condenser lens. Okay. Condenser lens. Okay. From there, we will come to the other part of the microscope. Okay. There will be a half silvered mirror here. Okay, which will divert the rays coming from the condenser lens toward the objective lens. Okay. So there will be an objective lens here. This is an objective lens. Okay, and this is half silvered mirror. Okay. Of course, there will be some focal length for this particular lens. Okay, then after this mirror, again there will be another lens here, which we will call as an eyepiece. This can be called as eyepiece, or this can also be called as projector lens. Okay, the image can be projected on a screen, or you can take this image and show it in the on your computer monitor. Okay, so now let's see. I'll start drawing the rays which are coming from the light source. Okay, so it will be diverging from the light source. So this condenser lens will be this light source will be at the focal point of this particular condenser lens. So after this, it will go parallel. Okay, something like this. Okay, and then this will be put on the objective lens. Okay, and from there, whatever object is placed here. Okay, suppose some object is placed here, these rays will fall on that. Okay, there will be some diversion towards the object here. Okay, after falling on the object, okay, my rays will now gets reflected toward the objective back, so it will go again towards the objective. Okay, from this, and after going from here, it will be parallel to the optic axis here, and this will be going through the focal point. Okay, and it will make another image here, which will be intermediary image. Okay, intermediate image will be there. Okay, and from here again, I will also have to draw a focal point for this particular lens. Okay, so this ray will go like this, this one is going like this, and after passing through the lens, it will become parallel to the optic axis, and this will go through the focal point to give you a magnified image here. Okay, so this is the whole schematic for a compound microscope. Okay, which is used in this kind of geometry, reflected microscope for a metallurgical application. Okay, now we want to understand, as you can see here, if I keep on putting lenses here, okay, for each lens there will be some magnification, okay, and I can keep on adding the magnification if I keep on adding the lenses here, okay, and that way I can go to any magnification I want, okay. But we cannot do that because with position of each lens, okay, the image deteriorates, okay, and that can be very nicely shown by this particular slide here, okay, where these three images are taken from an optical microscope, and the same from the same material another three images were taken from another type of microscope which is called scanning electron microscope, okay, and you can see that up to 300x if you see both the images, they have almost similar features, the sharpness of the image is same, the clarity of the image is same, okay, but if you come to 1400x here, okay, now you can see that the features which are shown in this optical micrograph, okay, are little bit blurred, they are not very clear, okay, whereas if you see the scanning electron micrograph here, the image, same image is very sharp, okay, all the features are very sharp, you can distinguish between the two different features, okay, or you can be, you will be able to see this sharp boundary between these two features here, where in this case it, the boundary is not very sharp, so you are not able to resolve it, okay. So in this compound microscope, as you can see, I have magnified this particular image of this particular object here, which is an intermediate image. Again, I can put another lens here and I can magnify the image further, okay, and I can keep on putting the lenses here and I can keep on magnifying the image, but there is a limit to that. I cannot keep on doing that because if you keep on putting lenses here, the resolution of the image will decrease with the magnification in case of optical microscope. Okay, the reason and to understand this resolution, that what do we mean by resolution, okay, I will come to this next slide here. The resolution is basically the closest spacing between two points which can, you can clearly see through a microscope as separate entities. You must be remembering when any friend who actually wears this kind of spectacles, okay, we usually joke, we will take his specs out and we will put two fingers and we will ask him kitne, how many fingers are there, okay, and you joke whether he will be able to say two or one or whatever, okay. So what we are trying to test for that particular friend, that whether he is able to resolve these two fingers or not without his spectacles, okay. So what we do in this fun activity is we are defining resolution, okay. So that is what is here also, that whether I am able to see two entities which are there in the sample, or features which are there in the sample, whether I am able to see them as two different features or two different entities or not, okay. So it is not, you can, should not confuse it with the, that it is the smallest point which can be seen with a microscope. A smallest point can be even smaller than the resolution, okay. A smallest point you can see is much smaller than the resolution. What we are trying to say is these two small points, how closer they can be, and we will still have, will be able to say that they are two different features or two different entities, okay. They should not be seen as one single unit or single entity, okay. To clarify this idea more, okay, and why this resolution problem comes in microscope or any optical optical system, okay, this is the concept what is, what we know as airy rings, okay. So the airy rings means when a parallel beam of light, when it passes through any contraction or any location where it is kind of constricted, it is allowed to go through a aperture, okay, then it gets diffracted, okay, and during this diffraction, as you can see in this particular slide, you get one central spot here, a bright spot, Then you get another ring here with another brightness, then you get the third ring here and so on. So one single light beam, okay, is divided into one beam, a central spot, then another ring and then another ring, okay, and the intensity is also plotted here, okay. So you can see the central spot is the most intense, then there is a second ring, okay, intensity is much lower, then the third ring and so on, and between two maxima there is always going to be a minima here, okay, and this is what is shown here in the schematic, a light beam going through opening here and it gets diffracted, okay. So you have a central spot here and the ring which you get is because of this, because this is a section, you see it as a two dimensional object, but it will be actually will be a ring. So when it goes through this opening, it will become a cone, a central beam and a cone, one first cone, second cone and so on, and which you on the screen will see is a central spot, first ring and second ring and so on, okay. So this parallel beam of light, when it goes through any opening, it has this formation of air ring. Now you can understand, from this light source we had first opening here, an aperture, a lens is there, so there must be a formation of air ring here. Then after reflection it goes through another lens here, there will be another set of apertures. I have not drawn here, okay, you can draw here a set of apertures, okay. Again it is going through an opening, okay, again there will be formation of air ring, okay. You come to the eyepiece, again there will be some aperture here also, okay, again there is an opening, again that, so this particular source has undergone this kind of air ring formation at three places, okay, and with each place the beam is dividing into multiple beams, okay. And why it will bring down the resolution, okay, we will just see in this next slide, okay, that there are these two sources, okay, two sources means there are two features which are emitting a light rays, okay. So how close we can see them to a separate, okay. So just you see this animation that I am bringing these two sources close to each other, and how much closer I can bring them together, that is what we want to see, okay. So this is what is the animation, okay. So you can see that this bright spot is almost coinciding with this bright spot here, okay. If I bring any closer than this particular position, then I will start looking it as one single entity, okay. And at this position what is happening is the maxima of this particular feature or spot is coinciding with the minima of this particular spot, okay, and that is what is plotted here in terms of intensity, okay. For first one this is what is the maxima, okay. For the second beam this is the maxima, and it minima of that is coinciding with the maxima of the first one. Similarly here the maxima of the second one is coinciding with the minima of the first one. So this is the closest I can bring them together. If I go any further than that, okay, then I won't be able to see these two features as separate entities, okay, and that is my minimum distance given by d1 by 2. d1 is your diameter of this particular central spot, okay, so this is equal to d1 by 2, okay, and that is what we are saying is my resolution limit or r1, okay, and which is given in terms of wavelength of light, or and I'll write down what do we mean by all this parameters here in this particular equation, okay. So lambda is wavelength of the light we are using, okay. Mu is refractive index of the lens material, and alpha is the half aperture angle. Okay, I'll just show schematic for that also to show you what do we mean by that. Okay, so this is my optic axis and this is my lens. Okay, so the and suppose this is my aperture. Okay, so a light beam going like this just next to the aperture, what is the maximum angle it can make? Okay, half of that, so alpha will be this angle, half aperture angle here. Okay, so this is my resolution can be expressed in terms of the wavelength which you use for a particular microscope, what is the refractive index of the lens, okay, and what is your half aperture angle. Okay, refractive index of the lens you can also understand, okay, if you wear these glasses or some of your friend wear glasses. Okay, so when they go to any optical shop, okay, and ask to make a new glasses for him, okay, he will ask that you want a normal kind of lenses or you want this high refractive index lenses. Okay, and what they do is, when you have this high refractive index lenses, your if your friend's power is very high, for example -3, -4, -5, then the thickness of the lens is going to be very high if you are not using a high refractive index glasses. But nowadays what we get in the market, these are all high refractive index glasses, of course made of polymers. Okay, and what they do is they bring down the thickness of the lens, so same power you can get with a very thin lens. Okay, and that is what is here also, that I can use a high refractive index material, okay, to have better resolution. Okay, in this case the resolution will be given by this. Okay, and mu sin alpha, which is shown here, is also called as numerical aperture of the that particular lens. Okay, so this criteria was given by Lord Rayleigh, and that is why it is called Rayleigh criterion. Okay, and it is explained in the statement here that what do we mean by that, and that defines my resolution. So now you can understand that when my light goes through different apertures, and in each aperture there is going to be formation of this airy ring, and these airy rings from different features are going to interact with each other. Okay, so it will going to reduce the clarity of the image. Okay, and I won't be able to see my all the features very clearly. Okay, because all these airy rings will interact with each other and bring down the clarity of the image. Okay, now to get best resolution, okay, how I can improve resolution of a microscope? Okay, what I have to do is I have to bring down my lambda. As you can see, my objective is to reduce R1. Okay, so R1 I can reduce if I bring the wavelength of the light I am using, or any electromagnetic radiation you can say, because in electron microscope, okay, we use electrons to do that, and the wavelength there is very small. Okay, so my resolution is very high in case of electron microscope. In optical microscope, we have to use visible light only. Okay, and for example, we can use a green light which has a 400 nanometer wavelength. Okay, I can again increase the resolution or reduce the R1, okay, by increasing the angle alpha. Okay, so I can open up the aperture, okay, to get maximum resolution, or I can use a higher index glass or glass material. Okay, so that will also will have better, will give you better resolution. Okay, so you can have sin alpha almost approaching 1 by using as large an aperture possible. Mu maximum, now I think what type of material we have in optical microscope gives mu of 1.7. okay, so these are all high refractive index medium that you can use. Okay, just for your information, resolution of a human eye is only 0.2 mm. okay, so this you can keep in mind. And you can use this value to find out that what can be the maximum useful magnification which you can have, okay, if your resolution is given by all these numbers. You just put all numbers like 400 nanometer here, sin alpha approaching almost 1, mu 1.7, and see how much is the resolution, okay, and that resolution has to be kind of the final resolution of your human eye is 0.2, and this is your resolution which you can get from the microscope. So their ratio will give you the magnification. Okay. Now, after knowing the resolution, there are some two more terms which can be of interest to any microscopist. Is what is the depth of field? Okay. So let me again draw a schematic here to show you what do we mean by depth of field. So this is my objective lens, okay, and of course this is my optic axis, and my rays are coming like this from here. They are intersecting at the focus there, okay. So from there I can tell you that this is my optimum focal distance or optimum focus I will get, or best image I will get if I have object here, okay. So this is where I will have optimum focus, okay, or optimum image. Now we have just seen that I am going to have some resolution possible, means I can bring two objects closer up to a distance of d1. And still I will be able to see them as two separate entities, okay. So from optimum focus, if I go up to any distance which is d here, okay, I should be able to not see any difference between the image, okay. So if my image plane or my object plane varies between these two limits, I won't be able to see any difference in the image because it is still in the my resolution limit, okay, and that distance I am giving by h, okay. So that is what is shown here, which is given by here 1.22 lambda upon mu sin alpha and tan alpha, okay. So that is my depth of field. Of course it is dependent on alpha here, as you can see, okay. So if I have a smaller aperture, I will have better depth of field. We can do calculations based on this in assignment, then you will be able to understand it better, that if I reduce the alpha, okay, then I will have a better resolution, a better depth of field. As you can see, if I reduce alpha, sin alpha and tan alpha, both values will be lower, okay, so the h will be higher, okay. So if I reduce the apertures, okay, angle, then my depth of field will be higher. But if you remember what we discussed in the resolution, my resolution will be poor. My depth of field will be higher, my resolution will be poor. I don't know if you have used this SLR cameras, or maybe some of your friends have this SLR camera, okay. You use this idea of aperture to increase or decrease the depth of field. Okay, suppose this you cannot do in a normal normal cameras, but SLR camera, you, because you do manual adjustment. So if you reduce the aperture, okay, if you have SLR camera, if your friend has an SLR camera, you can ask him that what you do, okay. So if you want to have image such that I am also in the focus, and something which is in front of me, maybe 100 let us say 10 meters in front of me, that guy is also in focus, what he will do, he will reduce the aperture, means he will reduce this angle alpha, and then both the subject will be in focus. But he wants to have a kind of bring the artistry into this thing. Sometime you see these images where a flower is in the front and you want to take a photograph of somebody who is behind that, and you want to keep this out of focus and bring that subject into focus, then you increase the aperture, okay. Now you can focus only at one point, either this flower, or you can have that subject in focus. Okay, so this aperture actually you play with in SLR camera to change the depth of field, and that is what is here. Okay, your depth of field will change if I change the aperture angle. Okay, and you can play with that. Of course, in optical microscope the depth of field is very small. Okay, and that is why you will understand that why we have to do polishing when we go to next lectures, that why we do polishing, because in optical microscope the depth of field is very small. Okay, and from that another concept which comes is called depth of focus. Okay, the depth of focus is basically, as depth of field is for the objective lens, the depth of focus is for the eyepiece. Okay, and you can see that it is magnification square of magnification times the depth of field. So it is very high. So if this is in micron, and suppose I am using a magnification of, let's say, 100, so it is 100 into 100, 10,000 times of the depth of field of micron length. Okay, so it will be something in mm or maybe centimeter. Okay, so depth of focus means, see, when you see all this optical, that this is my object, this is my lens, and some image is forming at this point. From this we understand that I have to be exactly at this position to see the image, because this is where the image is forming. If I go anywhere in this side or on this side, I should not be able to see the image. Okay, it defines a very clear plane on which the image is forming. Okay, so for a person, if he is, suppose he is seeing an image in a microscope, he has to be all the time at this particular location to see the image. Okay, and that is a you are putting a great restriction on him just to have at every point. Suppose he is watching that image for 10 minutes, for 10 minutes he has to be at that particular position, okay, to watch this the image. Okay, but that is not true. Actually, you have a leeway here that you can vary between these two and still you will be able to see the image, because you have some depth of focus here, and which is some order of magnitude times the depth of field. Okay, so it gives you some relaxation that I can be little bit changing my position and I still will be able to see the image. Okay, so that is what is depth of focus. Okay, so with this I think we have covered all our terms which are related to microscope. Okay, so thank you here. We'll now see the how we actually prepare sample for looking at the microstructure, and that is what we call as metallography. Thank you.